Everybody? Okay, good morning. Thank you for adjusting your schedules. Wasn't much we could do about that. Today is a very important lesson on suffering. So I'm really glad that you guys are here because I think a lot of people read this part of the book and they get scared and they think, oh, what is this about a bigger cross? So I really want to explain that today. Some people came up to me after the meeting on Tuesday and said, I'm so glad you explained that, because really, it's not exactly maybe what you're thinking. But let's begin with prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Oh my God, I firmly believe that you are one God in three divine persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe that your divine Son became man and died for our sins, and that he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe these and all the truths which the Holy Catholic Church teaches, because you have revealed them, who can neither deceive nor be deceived. Amen. August Queen of Heaven, Sovereign Mistress of the Angels, who did receive from the beginning the mission and the power to crush the serpent's head, we beseech thee to send thy holy angels, that under thy command and by thy power they may pursue the evil spirit, encounter them on every side, resist their bold attacks, and drive them hence into the abyss of woe. Most Holy Mother, send thy holy angels to defend us, to drive the cruel enemy from us. O good and tender Mother, thou shalt ever be our love and our hope. Angels and archangels, keep and defend us. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. This is the powerful intercession of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, your well-beloved spouse. Enlighten us, guide us, and increase in us all the virtues necessary to live a life totally devoted to Jesus through Mary. Instill in our hearts a filial love and dependence on the Mother of God. Give us great confidence in her maternal heart and an abiding refuge in her mercy, so that by her you may truly form in us Jesus Christ, great and mighty, unto the fullness of his perfect age. Amen. Mother of Good Counsel, Our Lady of Fatima, Our Lady of Guadalupe, patroness of the unborn, Saints Joachim and Anne, Saint Joseph, patron of the Universal Church, Saint Louis de Montfort, St. Maximilian Kolbe, Blessed Teresa of Calcutta, Blessed John Paul the Great, Father Patrick Gaffney, and Saints Felicity and Perpetua, our patron saints and guardian angels. Amen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Okay, and just a quick review from the last meeting, and we have begun the section of the book called Motives. And that is, again, to motivate us. He's trying to get us to desire to consecrate ourselves totally to Mary, to Jesus through Mary. And so the first three motives are what we got through last meeting. And the first one is that this devotion helps us to do everything for the service of God. So as we talked about, even when we're not thinking about it, that's what is a great gift of this. I was thinking about this just the other day when I was doing the laundry. I was reminded, oh good, this is, I'm doing laundry for your service, Lord. You know, it's just so nice. It's such a comfort. Again, unless we retract it, it's forever. The second motive then was that we actually imitate the Trinity. We imitate Jesus in his 30 years of, he was the first to be totally devoted to Mary. You know, he spent those 30 years with his parents. Of course, at some point, Joseph died, the church thinks, we're not sure when, but specifically to his mother for those 30 years. And that was, I think, to make a point, you know, that she's important and that submission and obedience is very important for all of us. Then also the we talked about imitating the Holy Trinity in general, just the Father's choosing Mary, the Holy Spirit being the spouse of the Blessed Mother, and of course being the mother of Jesus, and that they chose her. And so how can we not choose her? And then the third one that we got to was, which is one of my favorites, is that this devotion helps us to receive the Blessed Mother and her help and protection in a way that maybe we haven't before. So by inviting her in, she comes. You know, And she helps us in ways that we can't even imagine, really. She becomes such a beautiful, wonderful mother to us, even more so than she already is through our baptism. And we ended that with talking about how she purifies our prayers and us, and how she embellishes our prayers and us. And again, like I said, when I was praying my rosary at 11 o'clock yesterday for the cardinals, I thought, oh, this rosary can be for each cardinal. You know, it can be hundreds of rosaries. It can be thousands of rosaries. It can be whatever the Blessed Mother wants to use this one. It's just such a comfort to know that she's purifying and multiplying our prayers. Okay. So then today we start with the fourth motive. We're going to cover the fourth and the fifth. The fifth being the most popular, really, of all the motives. It's actually the most famous part of the book. Like if you were to go out and Google True Devotion to Mary, Total Consecration, there's a good chance that this fifth motive will pop up, which is that devotion to Mary is an easy, perfect, secure, and short path to union with Jesus. I mean, that's just, you'll hear that a lot by people who do this devotion or talk about this devotion. They'll talk about that fifth motive. So it's a very important one. It's kind of right in the heart of the book. So we'll spend the most time on that. But let's go ahead and read the fourth one, which is also wonderful. And that is that by total consecration to Mary, everything you do because of Mary's help goes for the greater honor and glory of God. And as I can't remember if it's Father Lance Harlow or somebody said, but this is what we, by our baptism, we're supposed to be doing anyway, doing everything for the greater honor and glory of God, but we forget. We don't think about it. Okay, and that's what St. Louis de Montfort alludes to in this paragraph. Paragraph 151, I'll go ahead and read. It says, the fourth motive is an excellent means of procuring God's greater glory. This devotion, faithfully practiced, is an excellent means of making sure that the value of all our good works shall be employed for the greater glory of God. Scarcely anyone acts for that noble end, although we are all under an obligation to do so. Either we do not know where the greater glory of God is to be found, or we do not wish to find it. But our Blessed Lady, to whom we cede the value and merit of our good works, knows most perfectly where the greater glory of God is to be found. And inasmuch as she never does anything except for the greater glory of God, a perfect servant of that good mistress, who is wholly consecrated to her, may say with the heartiest assurance that the value of all his actions, thoughts, and words is employed for the greater glory of God, unless he purposely revokes his offering. Is there any consolation equal to this for a soul who loves God with a pure and disinterested love and who prizes the glory and the interest of God far beyond his own? So this really is an amazing motive. If you really think about it, you know, if we really love God, we want to do everything for his honor and glory. But it's so interesting how he says either we don't know where to find it or we don't wish to find it. So let's look at question number one, if you have the new set, or it's actually question number five or six from the last section. I moved it over to this section. Question number six from the last meeting. Okay. Or question number one, if you have today's new questions. Okay. So it says, in 151, St. Louis de Montfort claims that the majority of people do not use their good works for the greater glory of God because either we do not know where the greater glory of God is to be found, or we do not wish to find it. What does this mean exactly, the greater glory of God? So first I'll define that. I just want to read you, though, in Scripture, St. Paul says, in 1 Corinthians 10:31, he says, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do everything for the glory of God. So it's right there in Scripture that we're supposed to have this really in the forefront of our minds, you know, and do we? You know, I mean, I'm not always thinking, am I doing this for the greater honor and glory of God? But we should be, you know, we should be. And so what's so great is that Mary's always thinking this, and so she's thinking it for us since we're united to her. All right, so I'm going to give you a couple of definitions. This first one is more of a physical definition of the glory of God, and this is Father Gaffney. And he says, glory is a visible manifestation of God's divine presence. In the Old Testament, there was the cloud, the pillar of fire, the burning bush, and the light when Moses' face shone. In the New Testament, God's glory is usually depicted by a bright light. the angels at Christmas, St. Paul on the road to Damascus, and the Transfiguration. Scripture says the world is full of the glory of God. So the glory of God is seen everywhere in his creation. So Father Gaffney says that we give glory to God in one way just by recognizing and honoring his creation and his works. Okay, that's one way to give honor and glory to God. But more a spiritual definition then of giving honor and glory to God in our works and our actions is by surrendering our will to his will. And if you remember from the last section when we talked about Jesus, why is it that he gave more honor and glory to God? Remember, by those 30 years of submission to his mother, than had he gone out and converted the whole world? And remember, we answered that it was because of his obedience. All right, so obedience to God's laws, obedience to anyone that God has put over you, that gives great honor and glory to God. That's really the way that we do it. And by surrendering ourselves also to his will. And we're going to talk about that today, what that means really even, you know, in suffering, especially. St. Faustina says in her diary, and this is number 724, she says, "Faithful submission to the will of God always and everywhere in all events and circumstances of life gives great glory to God. Such submission to the will of God carries more weight with him than long fasts, mortifications, and the most severe penances. Oh, how great is the reward for one act of loving submission to the will of God." So it's really beautiful to understand this, and that our little acts of, you know, obedience and submission to God's will during the day, we have to understand that that gives God such great glory. You know, to understand that will bring more joy to your life just by knowing that I'm going to surrender my will. I'm going to, you know, accept this is coming from your hand and see what I can learn from it, you know, rather than always fighting against the will of God. Those little acts. Okay. A couple things about the surrendering ourselves to the will of God. Someone brought this up a few years ago, and I thought it was so interesting, that there's actually four levels of surrender to God's will. Okay, the first is resignation to God's will. The second is conformity to God's will. The third is desiring God's will. And finally, the fourth and the highest level is loving God's will. And so each of these levels takes a tremendous amount of grace to grow. And the Blessed Mother, through this devotion, you know, moves us along these levels. Okay, so the first one, resignation. Now, it's virtuous just to resign yourself, but, you know, we tend to still sometimes complain or we don't really like it, you know, okay, Lord, you know, I accept this, but I don't like it, I wish I could change it, all right? So we're still resigned, you know, which gives God glory, but we're not really embracing it, okay? So the second level, conformity to God's will, then means that we are actually thinking about and praying about, Lord, I want my will to be more aligned with your will. I want to conform my actions to what you want. Okay, so that's the second level, and that's a little bit more, you know, mature way of thinking about it, or just more grace. And then the third is actually desiring God's will, and that's where we just, you know, abandon ourselves and say, whatever you want, that's what I want, no matter what it is. You know, doesn't necessarily still mean you're going to like it, right? But you're still just desiring it. You've matured to the point where you want what God wants. Okay. And then finally, the fourth level, loving God's will, as we're going to talk about today, is how do we even begin to love suffering, you know? But loving God's will is like at the level of many of the saints. St. Francis Xavier said, "Oh, to suffer more, Lord, to suffer more if it's your will," you know, this kind of love, no matter what happens. So at that fourth level, we just live, Jesus, I trust in you. You know, all of these levels, this should be what we're saying. But you embrace that motto more and more, the more that you can surrender yourself to God's will and eventually love God's will, which is hard. And, you know, this is where we seek to go. It's probably not any of us are there. I know I have a long way to go because suffering's hard. And that's what's really great about the fact that we didn't get to this motive last time, because it actually fits much better with the section today, which is on suffering. Okay, so why is it that, a couple of reasons I have here, why is it that we don't seek it, and why is it that we can't find it? God's will, or God, the greater glory of God, I'm sorry, it says, either we do not know where the greater glory of God is to be found, or we do not wish to find it. All right, well, there's several reasons for that. Number one is sin blinds us. You know, when we're following our own will, we don't even see what God's will is. We don't even, you know, we're so focused on our little limited view of whatever we're going through. We're so focused on that we just totally forget that there might be a bigger picture. There might be a reason, you know. And so sometimes we get prideful, and that can, you know, help us. That makes us blind to the will of God. So again, how do we fix this? Well, by obedience. You know, obedience helps us then. By obeying God's laws, you will be able to more clearly see the will of God in your life, okay? And with this devotion, then, what the Blessed Mother does is she reminds you. She reminds you, even in your sinfulness, she shows you what God's will is, you know? And it's great most of the time. Sometimes it's a real pain because, you know, I want to follow my own will. I don't want to know what God's will is. Sometimes that's just our fallen human nature sometimes, especially if it's hard. Okay, the other thing that makes us not is that it's too difficult. We don't want to follow God's will because we know it's hard, you know, and so we push it away. Okay, that would be another way. It's just we're too attached to our will and we don't want to go there. The third thing I have is that many people don't have a well-formed conscience, you know, and that hinders your ability to understand and see God's will. So we want to continually form our consciences. We want to read the catechism, read the encyclicals. I'm going to read to you today from John Paul II's encyclical on human suffering. I was like, hey, I finally read that. It was really great. It took me a long time because I'm a slow reader. But anyway, I was like, oh my gosh, he writes so beautifully. You know, I heard someone say with Pope Benedict's retirement that, you know, the next pope, he doesn't even really need to write anymore. We have so much that we could spend the rest of our lives, the rest of eternity, reading what these two popes have written that we don't even need anymore. You know, so I thought, we need to start doing these kinds of things and reading, informing our consciences. John Paul II, if you haven't done Familia, I know many of you have, but we read several of John Paul's encyclicals, especially the one on the family, you know, Familius Consortio, however you say it. Anyway, there's just so much that we can do. So we need to continue to form our consciences, do Bible studies, these kinds of things. Catholic Bible studies, Jeff Cavins, I highly recommend. These kinds of things are going to help us to see the will of God and to desire to do things for his glory, at least to know what his glory is. Okay. All right, so let's move on to the next motive, which, as I said, is the famous one. Now, this section is about the cross, you know, and I just want to say you're going to have a cross no matter what. You know, we're going to have them. And I was thinking about this the other day. If we didn't have a cross, then we would think this was our home, and we wouldn't ever want to leave, you know. So we've got our crosses because, like, get us out of here, you know. We want to go and spend eternity with God. I just was thinking, and there's that song, This Is Not Our Home, and I always think about that, you know, the suffering. It reminds us that this is not our home. But anyway, we're going to have a cross no matter what. So the question is, do you want help carrying your cross, or do you want to try to carry it by yourself? It's really what this comes down to, is that the Blessed Mother is such a help. She helps you carry your crosses. Sometimes they don't even feel like crosses. You don't even notice that you're carrying a cross because she makes them so light by the consolations that she gives and by the insights that she gives you while you're carrying them. All right, and it doesn't take she dulls the pain. She's like Tylenol, you know. You take it, it takes the edge off, you know. Okay, so let's go ahead and read a fifth motive. 152. This devotion is an easy, short, perfect, and secure way of attaining union with our Lord, in which union the perfection of a Christian consists. You know, I was thinking about this, the word union, the other day too, and it's like, I just think there's a lot of Christians out there who don't put enough emphasis on union with the person of Jesus Christ. And they focus more, and I've talked about this a lot this year, I know, but it hits me more and more, the more that Mary brings me into a closer union with Jesus, how beautiful that really is. But so many people focus on imitating Christ or, you know, doing his work, rather than
being united to him, truly focusing on him as a person who's alive, who loves you, who's your best friend. You know, I tell my little kids, he's your best friend. You know, I have a big picture hanging up in my room that my little boy drew. Jesus is my best friend. And I hang it up on the mirror because I just want everyone to see it who walks by. But, you know, this kind of thing that I heard on Sacred Heart Radio one time, and I won't even say the name because it was so painful to hear, but somebody said that somebody religious said, we need to get past Jesus and stop talking about Jesus so much and just start doing what he tells us to do kind of thing. As if we're like in this, you know, somehow taking away from doing what we should be doing because we're talking so much about our relationship with Christ. You know, it's like, if that isn't such a deception of the devil, you know, to think that, oh, I'll just do his work, but I'm not going to spend time talking to him, and I'm not going to spend time, you know, what I'm trying to say. So that this devotion, Mary, is so needed, because we can have this really close relationship. Let's say we do have a great relationship with Jesus and we talk to him. It can get so much better. And that's what she helps with. And I think, I can't even imagine not having her help. You know, she helps you to see things about the person of Jesus. She helps you to look at his wounds. You know, she helps you just to see his tenderness in ways that you couldn't without her help, because she knows him. She lived with him. And she can show you and reveal things to you about Jesus that there's no way you can know on your own, even just by reading scripture, because she knows him intimately. And so she starts to reveal things to you about Jesus. And it is such a gift, and it is such a joy. I mean, and so that's what this fifth motive is about. Okay, it's an easy way. That's easy, but it's not effortless, okay? So he says, first he describes what life is without Mary, and then he describes what life is with Mary, both of them having to do with suffering, okay? He says, it is an easy way. It is a way which Jesus Christ himself trod in coming to us, and in which there is no obstacle in reaching him. It is true that we can attain divine union by other roads, but it's by many more crosses and strange deaths, and with many more difficulties, which we shall find it hard to overcome. We must pass through obscure nights, through combats, through strange agonies, over craggy mountains, through cruel thorns, and over frightful deserts. But by the path of Mary, we pass more gently and more tranquilly. We do find, it is true, great battles to fight and great hardships to master. But that good mother makes herself so present and so near to her faithful servants to enlighten them in their darkness and their doubts, to strengthen them in their fears, to sustain them in their struggles and their difficulties, that in truth, this virginal path to find Jesus Christ is a path of roses and honey compared with other paths. There have been some saints, but they have been in small numbers, who have walked upon this sweet path to go to Jesus, because the Holy Ghost, the faithful spouse of Mary, by singular grace disclosed it to them. Such were St. Ephrem, St. John Damascene, St. Bernard, St. Bernardine, St. Bonaventure, St. Francis de Sales, and others. But the rest of the saints, who are the greater number, although they have all had devotion to our Blessed Lady, nevertheless have either not at all, or at least very little, entered upon this way. That is why they have had to pass through ruder and more dangerous trials. So what he's saying here is, and really in our day, there's many, many more. And especially now that we're in the age of Mary, what a blessing it is for us to enter upon this way, those who choose to do it. You know, but we can obviously add Maximian Kolbe and John Paul II, Mother Teresa, and many others, Pope Leo XIII, Pope John XXIII, Pope Pius VI. I mean, all the popes that we've had have entered upon this way of total consecration. But what he's saying here, and he's a poet, and so I always get a kick out of his, like, the way he describes things. But so he's saying without Mary, without this total consecration, that you'll have, and as I said, it's kind of funny, you'll have to go over craggy mountains, you know, cruel thorns, combats, obscure nights, strange agonies, frightful deserts. So he describes that, if you could read on, and actually Father Lance Harlow, he says here, that what he's talking about is emotional crosses that you'll endure without the help of the Blessed Mother. So what he's referring to here is fears, anxieties, uncertainty, doubt, mistrust, all these things that because of our fallen human nature and how tricky the devil is, that he's going to get us to suffer more on an emotional level. Father Lance Harless says,
anxiety, dryness, fearfulness, doubt, you know, all those kinds of things. So those are really heavy crosses for people. A lot of people, especially in our day and age, are carrying depression and fear and sadness and feeling like they're not loved by God, or that God is mad at them, or God has abandoned them. And with the Blessed Mother, through total consecration, she won't let you go there. At least if you do go there, she won't let you stay there for long. You know, she just like starts, what do you mean you're not loved by God? You know, she, come on, of course God loves you. And so that's one of the first things I always say that she teaches you is how loved you are. She helps you to establish your identity. Establish it so that you always are aware that you're the prodigal child that can always go run into the arms of the Father, no matter what you've done. But this, as simple as it sounds, is very difficult for people. You know, they get overcome by anxieties and fears and doubts and uncertainties. So these are heavy crosses that Mary helps to relieve you from, okay? But now let's go on. Because once those crosses are taken away, you still got to have a cross, right? So this is what he talks about in this paragraph. He says, how is it then that some of the faithful servants of Mary will say to me that the faithful servants of this good mother have so many occasions of suffering, that even more than others who are not so devout to her, they are contradicted and persecuted. They are calumniated, which means lied about. The world cannot endure them. Or again, they walk in interior darkness in the deserts where there's not the least drop of the dew of heaven. If this devotion to our Blessed Lady makes the road to Jesus easier, how is it that those who follow it are the most despised of men? Okay, so what I want to point out here is it sounds like we're going to still have a cross, which should be obvious, right? But he's talking about specific crosses here. You know, a lot of people read this and they're like, oh, I don't want to do this. I don't want more crosses. But, you know, he's not saying you're going to get cancer, you know, or people are going to start dying. He doesn't say that. He's very specific on the crosses. So let's look at this paragraph again very carefully, and I think you'll see that it's obvious, okay? So first thing he says, and there's really two that he mentions. I'm going to give you two more. I'm going to give you four or maybe five types of suffering that maybe you're not experiencing, but that you will begin to experience more. But again, Mary will be there to help you. So it's nothing to be afraid of. Okay, so he says, They are contradicted. They are persecuted. They are calumniated, and the world cannot endure them. That's number one. Basically, what he's saying is, you will be persecuted. How many of you are being persecuted right now? You know, Jesus says, the servant is not greater than the master. The world hated me, they will hate you. Are we all hated? I mean, I'm trying to be friends with everybody. I don't know about you guys, but, you know, it's like, I don't like people hating me. I don't want people hating me. But here's the thing. A lot of us have insecurities, a lot of us have fears, a lot of us have, that we don't want to say anything that's going to offend anybody. It's difficult for us to speak up in groups, you know, this kind of thing. But when Mary brings healing, she brings healing so that you have more boldness, you have more courage to evangelize. She helps, as we've talked about a lot this year, she helps to have the gifts of the Spirit well up in you so that you have more fortitude, you have more knowledge, more wisdom. You know, these kinds of things, so that it becomes easier for you to evangelize your neighbor. And so what's going to happen a lot of times when you evangelize, you're going to be persecuted. So Jesus warns us that this will happen. But so many of us, there's nobody hating us. There's nobody against us. There's nobody, you know, now in our own family, that might be different, right? And we're going to talk about that as we go on here. But because we're more comfortable maybe, especially in our own home. But anyway, so basically what he's saying here is persecution is the first cross that we can expect when we consecrate ourselves to the Blessed Mother, because she is going to give us more courage to evangelize. Okay, that's number one. Number two, And he's very specific here. He only mentions two crosses. The second one, he says, or they will walk in interior darkness, in the deserts where there is not the least drop of the dew of heaven. Okay, so he's talking about spiritual dryness here. And actually, and I just want to give you, Father Basil Cole helped me understand this, that in the spiritual life, there are three levels of growing in your union with Jesus, with God. I don't know exactly what the right wording is here, but there's the purgative state. Okay, so it's the state that you're in on the spiritual life. So there's the purgative state, the illuminative state, and the unitive state. And these all are going into deeper and deeper union with the Lord. So purgative is kind of the beginners once you've had a conversion. And many people stay in the purgative state and die in the purgative state. And that's fine. That's where you are. And that's, but bless a mother wants to move you along into deeper union. So she wants to move you into the illuminative, and then she wants to move you into the unitive. But anyway, the purgative state is what it sounds like. You're trying, you've had a conversion, and you're trying to root out sin in your life. You're trying to purge yourself. You know, you're receiving the sacraments, you're praying, you're asking for help. What Father Basil Cole said is that in this state, typically the kinds of darkness you're going to have is spiritual dryness. You know, you're not going to feel like praying sometimes, or you're not going to feel the consolations, or you're just going to busy yourself with other things. So it's kind of a, you know, we've all had it. Some of us are suffering it now. And a lot of times, and I've had people, once they make their consecration, boom, they go right into spiritual dryness, you know? And what I want to say about spiritual dryness is we have to start looking at it differently. We have to start looking at it as that God is trusting you enough to give you this. He's trusting you enough to give you a spiritual dryness so that you can prove your love to him, so that he can test you and stretch you. Because remember, when you're feeling all good and you're at church and the music's good and the homily's good and everything's beautiful and you're feeling good, how easy is it to say, oh God, I just love you, I praise you? I mean, how easy is it? It's so easy, right? How much harder is it when you're just not feeling it to still say, God, I love you? There is so much more merit. It is such a greater act of love to persevere through your rosary when you don't feel like praying it, you know, to tell the Lord that you love him. And I'm going to read to you something St. Therese said. She was in the unitive way. Let me finish going through the three ways first. But begin to try to look at your spiritual dryness as, hey, I'm going to use this time to show God that I love him, because it's harder. Okay, it means more. You see what I'm saying? So we have to really, I know I've said this before, but Mary is teaching me that these are chances for us to prove our love to God, you know, to continue doing those things when we don't feel like doing it, to continue loving him and praising him when we don't feel it. Okay, then the illuminative stage then is a deeper stage of union, and that's when you really are starting to be illuminated. You're starting to see and understand things about God. You know, a person in this stage, Father Basil, or I actually read, I just Googled them, and you can too. I'm not going to go into too much detail here, but this person in the illuminative stage spends a lot of time in meditation, you know, reading scripture, pondering it, trying to learn more. And again, I think people that do total consecration can quickly move into, you can, these stages all overlap, so you're still purging yourself, right? But you tend to see more. You know, you tend to receive a greater outpouring of the gifts of the Spirit, and so you know more. You start to have a greater wisdom of why things are happening. Okay, and that stage is a little bit greater than spiritual dryness. It's called the dark night of the senses. Now, I know you're probably familiar with the dark night of the soul, but there's something called the dark night of the senses. And that is basically what it sounds like, that it's deeper than spiritual dryness. It's actually where you don't feel on a sensible level. You don't feel anything. You know, you don't, it's hard for me to describe, but you just don't feel like God's presence. When you're used to feeling it, you just don't feel it. You know, and again, God is giving you that. He trusts you enough to give you that so that you can persevere through that. And so the third level then is the unitive level. And Father Basil Cole said that the dark night of the soul is reserved for those in the unitive level. And so the unitive, that is a person who generally can go into deep contemplation. So meditation, and now we're into contemplation, which is a gift. You know, and that's a person who is like we read St. Faustina's diary and Mother Teresa and some of these who are so united, they're done with the purgative state. You know, they have complete control over their passions and their sinful tendencies, and they've conquered that. You know, so now they're really, their focus is God all the time. So the dark night of the soul is even a deeper darkness. And this is what we heard Mother Teresa went through, that if you read St. Faustina's diary, she couldn't even get up off the floor. I mean, it was so intense. You know, so I'm going to read to you a little bit, but I want to finish reading this paragraph here. So those are the two crosses. I'm going to just actually, before I read on, give you a couple more. Okay, so total consecration is going to lead to persecution and spiritual dryness. I think we can handle that, okay? You know, don't be afraid. Blessed Mother, let me give you a few more crosses that I've personally, through this devotion, have experienced. The third one I would say is that Mary gives you a new heart and a new sensitivity, not toward yourself, but toward others. And so you're not focusing on, she actually heals the sensitivity of your heart so that you're not getting offended all the time. You know, you're not like, you know, getting hurt all the time. You're letting things slide. You know, you're saying they didn't mean it, and, you know, always trying to see the best in people and giving them the benefit of the doubt, you know? But she does help you to have a more sensitive heart toward others' pain. And so that's painful for you because you're being more empathetic. Okay, so that's another pain that can come. Another one I have is, well, really, is just that knowledge of self, which we've talked about a lot this year. And, oh, man, she's really showing me something about myself right now. It's really painful. But it's good. All good, you know, because I want to know these things. You know how there's people, they're doing something, and they have no idea that they're even doing it. You know, this is where we just let them, they don't even know, and, you know, but it's really, really arrogant or whatever it is that they're doing, but they don't even know. Well, we do those things too. You know, we do. We do things that we have no idea, and other people are looking at us saying, she doesn't even know, you know. She probably doesn't even know she's doing that, you know, if it's a really loving person. Otherwise, maybe you'll hear about it from somebody close to you. But anyway, so it's a good thing. I want to know if I'm doing things that are hurting people or if I'm doing something simple. I want to know. So Mary takes you up on that, and she starts showing you, and then it's like, oh, gosh, it's hard. But then you come closer to Jesus and ask him to heal you. And so those are the four things I would say that I've experienced going through this. Okay, let's go on, because this is really an important paragraph, 154, is when we are suffering these kinds of things, especially persecution, I think, is probably the hardest one, by our loved ones especially. It says, 154, I reply that it is quite true that the most faithful servants of the Blessed Virgin, being also her greatest favorites, receive from her the greatest graces and favors from heaven, which are crosses. But I maintain that it is also the servants of Mary who carry these crosses with more ease, more merit, and more glory. That which would stay the progress of another 1,000 times over, or perhaps would make him fall, does not at once stop their steps, but rather enables them to advance. Because that good mother, all full of grace and of the unction of the Holy Ghost, prepares her servants' crosses with so much maternal sweetness and pure love as to make them gladly acceptable, no matter how bitter they may be in themselves. And I believe that a person who wishes to be devout and to live piously in Jesus Christ and consequently to suffer persecution and to carry his cross daily either will never carry great crosses or will not carry them joyously and perseveringly without a tender devotion to Our Lady, which is the sweet meat and confection of crosses, just as a person would not be able to eat unripe fruits without great effort, in which he could hardly keep up unless they had been preserved in sugar. So another translation of this book says, she dips her crosses in honey. You know, so that is what she will do. And so that's why we don't need to be afraid of our crosses, because, as I said, we're all going to have them. But I would much rather have my mother carrying my cross with me and helping me and consoling me and telling me the reason. A lot of times she does, so many times will show me the reason, you know, and then it's like, this is not bad. I can do this, you know. It's for this reason. It's for me, or if it's for somebody else. It's for the church. So she reminds you of these things so that you don't get down. I want to read you a couple of things now on suffering that I have come across, that the Lord has kind of put on my heart to share. Father Lance Harlow says, total consecration leads to a capacity to bear our crosses with joy and perseverance and courage. That's what this devotion helps us do, because we're going to have crosses anyway, but if we want to carry them well, the Blessed Mother will help tremendously with that. Okay, first I want to read to you St. Therese. Therese, little flower. I came across this book called Joy in Suffering, and I'm like, all right, I gotta see what this says. Okay, she talks about her dark night of the soul. Okay, and listen to what she says. It's so beautiful. She says, for me, it is always night. And maybe you didn't know this about her. St. Therese, St. Therese, how do you say it? The little flower. Okay, Therese. Okay. She says, for me, it is always night, always dark, black night. Dryness and drowsiness, such is the state of my soul with Jesus. But since my beloved wishes to sleep, I shall not prevent him. St. Therese found these retreats especially trying. I went through the retreat in a state of utter dryness, as if abandoned by God. Jesus, as was his wont, slept in my little house. How rarely do souls allow him to sleep in peace? Their good master is so wearied with continually making fresh advances that he eagerly avails himself to the repose that I offer him. And no doubt he will sleep on until my great and everlasting retreat. But instead of being grieved at this, I am glad. What love. As she sees her darkness as Jesus sleeping and resting in her. I just was so moved by that. I thought, you know, we have so much to learn from the saints. And she says, when I am in this state of spiritual dryness, unable to pray or to practice virtue, I look for little opportunities for the smallest trifles to please Jesus, such as a smile, a kindly word when I would rather be silent. If no such occasion offers itself, I try at least to say over and over again to him that I love him. So again, these are great acts of love that we can make. You know, this shows Jesus that we love him when we're not feeling it. So we have to look at dryness differently, okay? Look at it as opportunities rather than focusing on ourselves and how bad we feel and, oh, it's so hard, rather than focusing on that. How can I turn this into an act of love for Jesus? You know, that's the great gift of our mother. You know, she helps us to see this. She reminds us of this. And we need reminders, right? We need lots of reminders. Okay, something else I just want to read about, because I didn't realize that I should have known, but how close she is to the Blessed Mother. It says, St. Therese's life of prayer centered in a very great measure about the Blessed Virgin Mary, and through her, the cause of our joy, she obtained the strength to suffer with joy. There is a charming ease and simplicity about her devotion to the Blessed Mother. She was simply a little child of Mary. Just as a little child often thinks of its mother, goes to her with confidence in every need and danger, does all it can to please her and give her joy, and especially delights in trying to imitate her in everything St. Therese did with regard to her Heavenly Mother. Let me read a little bit more. This also made her feel that Mary's motherly heart was filled with tender compassion for her children's suffering. And so in her anguish, she would plead, Mother, let my tired spirit rest beneath your veil. When she was in such pain that she could no longer pray, as she was formerly wont to do, she would say, I can only look at Mary and say, Jesus. Oh, with what fervor I have prayed to my mother. Utterly exhausted, I asked Our Lady to take my head into her hands that I might be able to bear the pain. So I just thought that was so beautiful because I hadn't read anything. It's not surprising, though. That she would be devoted to the Blessed Mother, such a great saint, and so beautiful and simple and full of love, and showed us what it's like to have joy in suffering. Okay, now I want to read a few things to read you. This one, so I read it out of it before, My Ideal Jesus. I finally finished it at someone's telling me, you've got to finish it. So I did. And it is so beautiful. This is the spirituality of Blessed William Joseph Chaminade, the founder of the Marianists. And I have kids at Moeller. I've mentioned that before. And so I took an interest in him right away, kind of started praying to him. Just got a video that someone sent me that a lady has. He was beatified in the year 2000 by Pope John Paul II, by the way. So, you know, I see John Paul II as looking at this Marian saint. Anyway, he's had another miracle now. And so I have been praying for his canonization, because I feel like we want to get these Marian saints canonized. It's going to bring a lot of grace to the church. It's going to bring a lot of grace to, well, our Marianist schools, well, all our schools. But anyway, so this is his spirituality, which to me, as I said, is amazingly similar to St. Louis de Montfort's. And they lived right around the same time. They're both from France, but St. Louis de Montfort's book was buried at the time, and so he never read it. But it's so similar that you know that it's truth, because it's the same. Okay, and here's what he says about the cross. Now, he's using the Blessed Mother's as if she were speaking. And maybe he had an apparition of Mary, I don't know. But this is what she says through him. My child, listen and try to understand. I wish to teach you a doctrine which is all the more difficult to grasp because you imagine that you are quite familiar with it, and that is the doctrine of salvation by the cross. All those who take part in the Christian apostolate know that suffering plays in a paramount role in the saving of souls. They know that Jesus delivered the world from the bondage of sin by his passion and death, that I had to become the mother of sorrows in order to become co-redemptrix, and that all great apostles pass through great tribulations. But when suffering is upon them, they forget its significance. They are surprised and discouraged. For them, as for the Jews, the cross remains a stumbling block. Do they imagine that they can take part in Christ's redeeming action unless they also share in his redeeming passion? But there is another cross, much more difficult to carry because it is so disconcerting. Your intentions, and this is the persecution, your intentions will be misunderstood, your plans ridiculed, and your activities blamed. Those to whom you might look for aid will prove indifferent to your work, or else will go about tearing down what you have tried to build up. The cross of your own choosing you carry joyfully enough. The cross imposed by you upon you by sickness or poverty, you succeed in accepting with resignation. But the cross prepared for you by the ignorance and maliciousness of men threatens to disgust you. Still, it is just this last cross which has the greatest redemptive power. Look at Jesus. Was it self-imposed suffering which he saved you? Was it not rather the suffering caused by the ignorance and the maliciousness of men, of the very men whose function and profession should have prompted them to aid him in his work? Do not be astonished if the devil tries to ruin your work. When he attacks my soldiers, he is really attacking me. Keep up your confidence and courage. As a result, his defeat will be all the more complete. I have crushed his head, and I will continue to crush it forever. But remember that suffering has no redemptive power in and of itself, but only when it is united to the sufferings of Jesus. The same law holds for your suffering as for your person. Alone, you are only weak. United to Jesus, you participate in his divine nature. When suffering comes to you in your apostolic labors, come and press closer to me. Okay, I skipped a page. I want to make sure I read this, because I think this is important, something that we forget. Before every apostolic effort, meaning before you do anything for God, in addition to praying, offer a sacrifice. If the work is particularly difficult, prepare and accompany it with particularly hard sacrifices. If you have not succeeded after the use of ordinary means, do not say, I have worked, preached, pleaded, and prayed. I have done all I could. So long as you have not really offered a sacrifice, you have no right to say that. You know, and that is what Scripture tells us. Only some things can only be driven out by prayer and fasting. So we don't want to do the fasting part. We don't want to do the sacrificing part. But it adds so much power to what it is we're trying to do, you know. I heard a priest say one time that before he gives a talk, he fasts. Actually, he's an exorcist, Father Eitnauer from Human Life International. He would fast a whole day before he would enter into exorcisms, stuff like that. So we have to acknowledge this and use this, especially in this day and age, right? Okay, a couple more things. I'm going to read to you some tips that St. Louis de Montfort gives in carrying our cross, okay? And that is, he wrote something called a letter to the Friends of the Cross. Okay, It's in the Catholic Family Land book. It's called A Letter to the Friends of the Cross. I'm telling you, I mean, it is very difficult to read. It is harsh. You know, he wrote it 300 years ago to a very different audience. So good luck if you read it. But you might want to just skip to the end. At the very end of the article, I think he gives very helpful tips on how to carry your cross. He calls it the 14 rules for carrying your cross, okay? I'm going to go over a couple of those today. But before I do, I want to read, as I said, I read John Paul II's encyclical on human suffering. It is beautiful. Okay? I encourage you to read. But I'm going to read to you a couple of things here that he says. He starts out with St. Paul's verse in Scripture. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. He says, the joy comes from the discovery of the meaning of suffering. Once your suffering has meaning, then you can find joy in it. Fulton Sheen said, hospitals are places of such wasted suffering. You know, we don't want to waste our suffering because it's extremely powerful. Some suffering must serve for our conversion. That is, for the rebuilding of the goodness of the subject who can recognize divine mercy and this call to repentance. Okay, so, you know, he's not saying that all your suffering is because God is trying to convert you or that punishing you or something. You know, we just read in the Scripture not long ago, the gospel was Jesus talked about that tower that fell on those people. Well, it wasn't because of their sin or anything. But what he's saying, I think John Paul is saying here, is that we can still ask ourselves, not so much in the really heavy, heavy crosses, but the little daily crosses, is what are you trying to teach me? You know, what is it that you want me to learn through this humiliation? You know, or this difficulty. So we can be asking ourselves and try to see our suffering as a way of growing in our faith and converting and rooting out sinfulness in our lives. Okay, he says, human, and you know a lot of this, but I just think he words it so beautifully. Human suffering has reached its culmination in the Passion of Christ, and at that same time, it has entered into a completely new dimension and new order. It has been linked to love. Suffering has been linked to love. The cross of Christ has become a source from which flows the river of living waters. And there's so much to read, but I'll not read it all. Just the highlights, what I thought. And you've heard this. St. Paul says, for this slight momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. St. Peter says, rejoice insofar as you share in Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. So I know that's hard for us to do sometimes. It says, on the cross, Christ, I think this is really important for us to understand, and it really kind of goes into the next couple paragraphs, what we're going to read. It says, on the cross, Christ, by fulfilling the will of the Father, fully realized himself. Okay? It says, in weakness, he manifested his power. And in humiliation, he manifested his messianic greatness. Are not the words which he uttered during his agony on Golgotha a proof of this greatness? And especially his words concerning the perpetrators of his crucifixion, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Suffering is an invitation to manifest the moral greatness of man, his spiritual maturity. So we're going to talk about spiritual maturity today, and suffering stretches us so much so that Jesus could say, forgive them. You know, that's the greatness of a person, is the ability to forgive. I mean, we do it with help, but with God's help. But I just thought that was such an interesting statement, that it was while he was hanging on the cross that he was at his greatest, that he could forgive those who were killing him. And this is one of my favorite scripture verses on suffering. St. Paul says, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, which has been given to us. suffering, as it were, contains a special call to virtue, especially the virtue of perseverance. By this, the individual unleashes hope, in which he maintains the conviction that suffering will not get the better of him, that it will not deprive him of his dignity as a human being. John Paul writes, man discovers himself more and more fully in suffering. A few more. He says, down through the centuries and generations, it has been seen that in suffering there is concealed a particular power that draws a person interiorly close to Christ. And this is a special grace. And many of the saints experience this. And I think we can all say that we've, at times in our suffering, have felt God's presence even more so, you know, than when we're not suffering. It says, and then this is beautiful. He writes, for a person close to Christ, when the body is gravely ill, totally incapacitated, and the person is almost incapable of living and acting, all the more do interior maturity and spiritual greatness become evident, constituting a touching lesson to those who are healthy and normal. And I think we've seen this in people who are saints in their suffering. Okay, and then this is beautiful. I had to share this. This is not all, John Paul writes. The divine Redeemer wishes to penetrate the soul of every sufferer through the heart of his Holy Mother. The dying Christ conferred upon Mary, the ever-Virgin Mary, a new kind of motherhood, a spiritual and universal motherhood toward all human beings, so that every individual during the pilgrimage of faith might remain together with her, closely united to Jesus on the cross, so that every form of suffering, given fresh life by the power of the cross, should become no longer a weakness of man, but the mighty power of God. So this reminds me of, I'm going to send this to you. Someone sent me a video of Father Michael Gately, who wrote the 33 Days to Morning Glory. And it's so awesome. He talks about the divine mercy and Mary being the mother of mercy. But what he says at the end is that, well, he says that he did the total consecration to St. Louis de Montfort when he was a freshman in college. And that, like, then for years he felt like Mary was mad at him because he wasn't doing his daily rosary. And he just... he didn't feel as close to her that like he wished that he had until he wrote 33 Days to Morning Glory, and he read St. Maximian Kolbe's devotion and John Paul, and it totally changed him, because how they describe, especially Maximian Kolbe, as being our little mother, and how gentle and tender and kind. And he said he realized that Mary wasn't gone. She just had gotten behind him and was pushing him from behind closer to Jesus. And I think that is a beautiful way, like we talked about last time. She doesn't get in between, you know, she kind of is like around pushing us closer in this union with Jesus. But what he said was, at the end, is that what she was pushing him to the pierced side of Christ. That's where Mary brings us, to the pierced side where the divine mercy flows upon us. You know, where the blood and water which gush forth on the side of Christ, that's where Mary's leading us, you know, to contemplate his sufferings. And to see them, I just thought it was so beautiful. I'll send you that video if you have time to watch it. He's an excellent speaker. Okay, one more. He says, I thought this was important. He says, a source of joy can be found in overcoming the sense of the uselessness of suffering. You know, the world sees it as just totally useless suffering. He says that feeling is very strongly rooted in human suffering. He said the discovery, then, of the salvific, redemptive meaning of suffering in union with Jesus transforms this depressed feeling. Faith in sharing in the sufferings of Christ brings with it an interior certainty that the suffering person completes what is lacking in Christ's afflictions, the certainty that the spiritual dimension of the work of redemption is what he is serving, like Christ, in the salvation of his brothers and sisters. Therefore, he is carrying out an irreplaceable service to the church. It is suffering more than anything else which clears the way for grace which transforms human souls. In the cosmic struggle between the spiritual powers of good and evil, human sufferings united to the redemptive sufferings of Jesus Christ constitutes a special support for the powers of good and opens the way to the victory of these salvific powers. And finally, he says, the springs of divine power gush forth precisely in the midst of human suffering. Those who share in the sufferings of Christ preserve in their own sufferings a very special particle of the infinite treasure of the world's redemption. It can share this treasure with others. And then I thought this was really amazing. And in our day and age, it says, the more a person is threatened by sin, and the heavier the structures of sin are in the world, the more the eloquence which human suffering possesses in itself, and the more the church feels the need to have recourse to the value of human suffering for the salvation of the world. So I was thinking about this last night and how, you know, we are living in such evil times. And so what he's saying there is that by us suffering well, by us not striking back and not getting revenge, you know, and by us not gossiping, that's how people are changed, you know, because the more sinful the world is, the more powerful your suffering well becomes, because people look at you and they say, oh my gosh, I know we've all experienced this, you know, something as simple as returning money, someone who's given you too much money. I mean, I wouldn't necessarily call that a suffering, but, you know, when you do these acts of virtue, especially when you suffer, and you suffer well, you change people. That it has such power to change hearts, not to mention the grace that's attached through uniting it with Jesus. But I mean, just your example, just your witness, the more sinful the world, the more powerful your acts of uniting your suffering to Christ become. That's what John Paul is saying. So we have an amazing opportunity in our day and age right now to save souls through our suffering, by suffering well. So that's what St. Louis de Montfort is saying here, is that the Blessed Mother is going to help you to suffer well. I mean, that's what I want. You know, I want to, because we're going to suffer no matter what, I want to be able to suffer well. You know, I fail, but let's see what St. Louis de Montfort has to say. He gives us some tips, okay? At the end of this Friends of the Cross, which, as I said, is, you know, you can read it, but depending where you are in your spiritual life, you may not like it. You may love it. I don't know. I read it every year just to, like, see how far I've come. But it's harsh. Anyway, I do love these 14 rules. I'm going to give you a couple of them, and you can Google this. But the first rule of suffering, he says, is do not deliberately cause crosses upon yourself, you know, by your own fault. I'm like, well, that's good to know. Now, he's not necessarily talking about, you know, offering things up during Lent or anything, but he says here, do not deliberately contrive to bring crosses upon yourself. We must not do something wrong in order to bring about something good, nor must we, without a special inspiration of God, do things badly in order to draw down ridicule upon ourselves. Rather, we ought to imitate our Lord, of whom he said, do all things well. And I like the sense. He says, if you fulfill the duties of your state as well as you can, you will find no lack of opposition, criticism, ridicule, and crosses, right? So we just have to do what we can and do it well. There'll be plenty of crosses. You know, we don't have to go seeking them. So I thought that was kind of good advice. The second thing he says, and this is important, ask for the wisdom of the cross. Ask for the wisdom of the cross. He says you should, and you should pray for the wisdom of the cross. That knowledge of the truth which we experience within ourselves, and which by the light of faith deepens our knowledge of the most hidden mysteries, including that of the cross. Okay, so I'll get into that a little bit more on wisdom of the cross. But just, I put that on my prayer intentions once in a while, you know, teach me the wisdom of the cross, the mystery of the cross. Okay, he says, humble yourself for your faults without worrying. So what he's saying, if you make a mistake which brings a cross upon you, whether inadvertently or through your own fault, humble yourself. Allow God to teach you humility. So basically he's saying, You know, let it go. When you make mistakes, especially when we hurt people, it's so hard. I know how painful it is, but just throw it into the heart of Jesus. I had to do that this morning at Mass. You know, just your heart is a burning furnace. You know, take this weakness, take this pain, take this hurt, whatever it was, take it and then bring good. You know, because we remember that God will always, Romans 8:28, bring good. Even through our sins, it's hard to imagine that he does. But even through when we hurt other people, you know, we're sorry and we hate that we did that. But if we just give it to him, he can bring good out of it. And to keep that in mind. Okay, he says, profit by little sufferings rather than great ones. Take advantage, and this is something we already talked about a little bit. Take advantage of the little sufferings, even more than the great ones. Consider not so much what God considers not so much what we suffer as to how we suffer. Do what a shopkeeper does in regard to his business. Turn everything into profit. Do not allow the tiniest piece of the cross to be lost, even though it only be something small, like a small annoyance, a paper cut, some intentional slight, a little anxiety, a little body weariness, or pain in your limbs. Turn everything into profit, and soon you will become rich before God. Okay. He says, at the least annoyance, say, thank you, Lord, thy will be done. This trains us to move up those levels, you know, to desiring, you know, conforming ourselves and desiring and loving and the cross. Okay. He says, now this is important. Love your crosses, but not with an emotional love, but with a rational and supernatural love. This was very helpful to me. He says, there are three kinds of love. Emotional, okay, rational, and supernatural love. God does not ask you to love the cross with the will of the flesh. It is this human will of our Lord in the Garden of Olives when he said, Father, let this cup pass from me. And he was suffering. The lower part of Christ's nature, although holy, could not love the cross continuously. Then with still greater reason will our tainted nature reject it. Okay. He says, there's another love of the cross, which I have called rational love, which is the higher part of man and the mind. It springs from the knowledge of how happy we could be in our suffering for God and could be experienced by the soul. Okay, so that is thinking it, you know, through your mind, I offer it up. You know, you think to yourself, offer it up for somebody in purgatory or for someone not to have an abortion today, and to trust that you're offering it that can help you not to have to, it can help you to love your suffering, but not, you could still be in pain and your body isn't loving it. Okay, I thought this was helpful. And then he says, and then third, there is a supernatural love, which is the highest love. And that is actually feeling joy. Without feeling joy in the senses, you can love the cross by pure faith and take delight in it, even though the lower part of your nature may be in the state of conflict and disturbance, groaning and complaining, weeping and longing for relief. He says, you can simply say, Father, thy will be done, not mine. Or with Our Lady, I am the handmaid of the Lord, be it done unto me according to thy word. So it's even a higher level, a spiritual level, where you're resigning yourself to the will of God. Okay, Mary helps you to move up the levels, you know, as I said. But I thought that was helpful. All right. He says, when you suffer, consider these four things: the eye of God, the hand of God, Christ on the cross, and heaven. Okay, so he says, God sees you in your suffering. He never takes his eyes from you. You know, he's with you. Now, he may have ordained a certain suffering, or he may have allowed a certain suffering. We talked about this a little bit, but I think this is so tremendously helpful in the spiritual life to understand that God allows things. He ordains them or he permits them. Now, if somebody sins against you, obviously God did not do that. He hates sin, but he gave us a free will. So people are going to sin against us. But what God does is he brings good. As long as we give it over to him, he will somehow turn it into good for us or for the person. You know, and that's the good news. Okay, so that's the eye of God. And then the hand of God, well, actually, that's really the same thing. It either comes from him, we accept our sufferings, you know, either from him or that he allowed it for some, to bring some greater good. And actually, I'm going to read you. This is, I sometimes hang this up on my refrigerator when I'm really suffering. I pull this quote out of St. Francis de Sales. I want to read this to you. He says, "The everlasting God has in his wisdom foreseen from all eternity the cross he now sends to you as a gift from his inmost heart." It doesn't feel like a gift sometimes, right? Or ever. He says, "This cross he now sends you, he has considered with his all-knowing eyes, understood with his divine mind, tested with his wise justice, warmed with his loving arms, and weighed with his own hands, to see that it not be 1 inch too large for you, 1 ounce too heavy for you. He has blessed it with his holy name, anointed it with his consolation, taken one last glance at you and your courage, and then sent it to you from heaven as a special greeting from God to you, an alms of the all-merciful love of God." So that is sometimes hard, but that's where we pray for the wisdom of the cross, you know, the wisdom to know and to understand that it's all love. Even though it's painful, it's love. I know it's hard. It's hard. And the world doesn't see it. But we need to be witnesses to this, to the love of God. God loves us. He wants us to be in heaven with him. Just like he told Blessed Mother told St. Bernadette, "I don't promise you happiness in this life, only in the next." You know, but with Mary, you can be happy in this life too. I mean, she just brings so much joy and consolation to your heart that you experience the happiness in this life too. It's just a gift of being close to the Blessed Mother. Okay, a few more here. I'm going to watch the time. But I just wanted to spend a lot of time on suffering because I know a lot of you are really suffering. And my heart just breaks, you know, for so many people who are suffering so much. And we just have to remember that, how powerful our prayers are. Give them to Mary for that person. You know, ask her to console them. And she will. All right. This is a good one. Never complain. Okay. Here's what he says. There's three levels of complaining. There's always levels, right? And so he says, never willingly complain against any person that afflicts you. There are three levels of complaints that we make in times of distress. The first is natural and spontaneous, as when the body groans and complains, weeps and laments. There is no fault in this. Okay, as long as the heart is resigned to God. You know, we're going to cry. We're going to weep. We're going to have pain. You know, we're going to moan. We're going to do these things. This is not a sin. Okay, sometimes people think that's a sin. This is just where the scrupulosity comes in. You know, you have to. That's not sinful. Okay, then he says, the next level is, the second kind of complaint is of the mind. When you make known your pain, but to someone who can give you relief like a doctor, there is no sin in this. Or you come to the healing teams. Or sometimes I just have to call my mom and just vent or whatever, pour out my grief to her. It's because I know she's going to pray for me. You know, I still am careful. I don't want to scandalize. I don't name names most of the time. You know, because I don't want the names out there, but I just say so-and-so, whatever, and will you pray for me? So that, you know, is less perfect. But here, the third kind, then, he says, is sinful. That is when we criticize our neighbors with gossip, or we seek revenge on them, or when we willingly complain of what we suffer with impatience and murmuring, with no intention of, you know, getting prayers or anything. So, it's kind of common sense, but, you know, we don't want to gossip. We don't want to ruin the reputation of people. We want to, you know, just offer it to Jesus, unite it with his cross. He says, accept your cross with gratitude. Okay, we can work on that, right? And then finally, he says, seems like I missed a page, to take up some voluntary crosses. Okay, some of them, obviously during Lent, we do this. He said, well, I guess I didn't skip anything. He says, if you're going to take on a more severe kind of suffering, like we found out that John Paul II had a cord that he whipped himself, and some of the saints, you know, really scourge themselves, that we never want to take on, or even just something that might cause us to be, you know, like a hair shirt, those really aren't available anymore, but it's something that's going to cause us discomfort because we want to offer it up, that you really have to do that under the guidance of a spiritual director, you know, because you would never want to take upon some pain upon yourself and then take it out on your family. You know, I was heard, you know, someone on the radio saying, well, I'd like to give up coffee for Lent, but then my family will feel the wrath of that. You know, so you have to use prudence when you take on voluntary crosses. You really do. You know, if you can't do it joyfully, maybe you shouldn't be doing it. Okay. But obviously we do. It's important in the spiritual life to make sacrifices, and not just during Lent, as we've talked about. You know, Friday should be a day of something that you can deny yourself. Okay. All right. So I know I spent a lot of time on that. Let's look at question number one. We're just now in question number one at 5 till 11. But that's all right. We'll get through it. Okay. St. Louis de Montfort acknowledges that there are many paths to union with God, but says that compared to the path of Mary, the others are difficult and wearisome. Father Gaffney says that Jesus Christ not only took the path of Mary, that he made the path of Mary at the incarnation. It can be unsettling to read in 153 that the servants of Mary will carry heavier crosses than those who are not devoted to her. But he just said in the previous paragraph that those who are not devoted to her will suffer much more. So which is it? Okay, we've hopefully have explained that. The answer lies in understanding the cross. Through total consecration, Mary teaches us the wisdom of the cross. Explain how her motherly love makes our crosses in life easier to bear. Well, really, for those of us who are mothers, you just need to think of how you mother your children when they're hurt, right? So, but she does it infinitely better than we do, because sometimes we make them feel better just so they'll be quiet. You know, we have some selfishness attached to our comfort. But the Blessed Mother, she comforts us. She really does. When you let her in, she consoles you. She oftentimes, as I said, shows you the reason. She helps you to pull back from your little limited view and to see the big picture. She reminds you to offer it up. You know, she's always, Father Carapi used to say, she's always on my case. You know, she's always reminding you, and she does. She's always putting thought, and remember, it's through your guardian angel that oftentimes that she will, you know, the more close you get to your angel, the more these light bulbs are going to go off. And so you're not just in darkness when you're suffering, that you have lights going off all the time. You know, this is how it should be. Now, sometimes there will be no light at all, as we discussed, in which case we just do our best to make little acts of love, like St. Therese. Okay, she helps you to avoid self-pity. I think that's a big one. I know I suffer with that. You know, she helps us not to have that woe is me and looking around at everybody else and thinking my situation is so much worse. She helps you not to do that. She helps you to learn from your mistakes. Again, a mother does with your child. You try to help them learn from their mistakes. It's sometimes hard to do. She helps you to get back on your feet. She leads you to the confessional. She leads you to Mass. She tries to get you there as often as you can. I mean, she can't force you to do anything, but she'll put these thoughts in your mind and in your heart. And I just count on it so much. I mean, her little inspirations that she sends me when I'm suffering, it's just, sometimes I feel like I just fall into her arms. I had two really severe sufferings in the last year that happened on the eve of one of her feast days. It was both of them. And that next day at Mass on her feast day, I sat in church and cried, but I just felt like I fell into her lap. It was just so beautiful. And that was not a coincidence. You know, that was mother mothering me through it. So you will suffer, you won't suffer as long and as hard with her. Okay, so let's go on because one thing I just want to add here is, now I'm thinking I didn't get to, when he said those four things, the eye of God, the hand of God, the passion of Christ in heaven, I forgot to mention the passion of Christ. Mary brings us to the foot of the cross. Mary wants us to focus on the passion. Sometimes it's hard. Sometimes when we're really suffering, we can't even look at the cross. It's just, all we can do is try to say Jesus, right? But it's when we're not suffering, that's the best time to really take the time to meditate on the Passion. I've already said, watch the Passion of the Christ. You know, I always watch it on Good Friday. It means I look forward to it as much as I dread it, you know, because I know Mary teaches me so much. It's like she's sitting next to me when I'm watching it. She's showing me, she's pointing things out, you know. But the display of Mary in that movie is so amazingly awesome and profound, because if you'll notice, next time you watch it, every time Jesus sees his mother, his strength is regained. Watch it. Watch for that next time. That's what she does for us, all right? She mothered him all the way up to the cross. She wasn't weeping and wailing and couldn't, you know, at the foot of the cross. She was helping him die. She was right there to help him, you know? And that's what she does. She helps us. So I wanted to make sure I mentioned that, is make sure that we continue to do that. And not only his sufferings, but from time to time to meditate on her sufferings, the seven sorrows. You know, that's important too. And I have found personally, and I try to do when I go to adoration a lot of times, is pray the seven sorrows rosary, Immaculate. The meditations in that little booklet are so good. But I have found courage to suffer better. You know, that's what she gives us. She gives us the courage to suffer well when we meditate. So don't skip that. Don't miss that in your life. Don't miss that opportunity to really meditate on their sufferings, because there are great graces attached. The next time your suffering comes along, you will find that you will have more strength. Now, I have experienced that in my own life. Okay, and then heaven, the fourth one was keep your eyes on heaven, like St. Paul says, you know. If you suffer well, I had heard someone say that the saints, if they had one wish in heaven, if they could leave heaven, which they wouldn't want to ever do, but if they could, it would be come back to earth to suffer more, which is hard for us to understand. But that they saw the value of the cross. They saw the souls that were saved. Okay, so Mary reminds us to focus on that we're saving souls, you know, through our suffering. It's easier just to sit and pray a rosary. But really, uniting your sufferings is where that power comes in. Okay, and to not forget that. She reminds you. Okay, so let's go on. To the next part of this fifth motive, which is that total consecration is a short way. Okay, we saw easy. Funny that it should be entitled "It's an Easy Way" and it's all about suffering, right? But there's some truth to that. She helps you. Your crosses become lighter. I mean, they just do. They will. You will experience it. Okay, it's a short way. This devotion to our Blessed Lady is a short road to find Jesus Christ, both because it is a road from which we do not stray, and because, as I have just said, it is a road that we tread with joy and facility, and consequently with promptitude. We make more progress in a brief period of submission to and dependence on Mary than in whole years of following our own will and of relying upon ourselves. A man obedient and submissive to Mary shall sing the signal graces which he shall gain over his enemies. They, meaning the demons, will try to hinder his advancing or to make him retrace his steps or fall. This is true. But with the support, the aid, and the guidance of Mary, he shall advance with great strides toward Jesus, without falling, without drawing back one step, without even slackening his pace, along the same path by which he knows that Jesus also came to us with great giant strides and in the briefest space of time. So you'll see, we talked about this last time too, that obedience, the devil hates when we're obedient. You know, he flies. And so by being little acts of obedience, it says here, a man obedient and submissive to Mary shall sing the signal graces which he shall gain over his enemies. So it really is that you bring more hardships upon yourself through disobedience. You allow the devil in, and then he works on you, and he messes with you. So really, it's by those little acts of obedience, you know, as we talked about, even to our husbands, as hard as that can be sometimes, it really does makes, you know, I think of the devil just flying right out of there, you know? And then sure enough, I'll experience the grace a lot of times afterwards by being obedient. I know it's hard, but it's true. Obedience is powerful. Okay, 156. Why do you think that Jesus lived so few years on earth, and of those few years, spent nearly all of them in subjection and obedience to his mother? The truth is that, being perfected in a short time, he lived a long time, longer than Adam, whose fall he had come to repair. although the patriarch lived above 900 years. Jesus Christ lived a long time because he lived in complete subjection to his Holy Mother and closely united with her in order that he might thus obey his Father. For one, the Holy Ghost says that a man who honors his mother is like a man who layeth up treasure. That is to say, he who honors Mary, his mother, to the extent of subjecting himself to her and obeying her in all things, will soon become exceedingly rich, because he is every day amassing treasures by the secret of that touchstone. He who honors his mother is as one who lays up treasure. And two, because according to the mystical interpretation of the inspired text, my old age is to be found in the mercy of the bosom. It is in the bosom of Mary, which has surrounded and engendered a perfect man, and has had the capacity of containing him who the whole universe could neither contain nor comprehend. It is, I say, in the bosom of Mary that they who are youthful become elders in light and holiness, experience, and in wisdom, and that we arrive in a few years at the fullness of the age of Jesus Christ. And so see how this ties so well with the whole maturity. So we say this in our prayers, the fullness of the age of Jesus Christ. And maybe you've been wondering all year, what does that mean? So let's look at the second question. He says, St. Louis de Montfort says that Mary, or it might be the third question, depending if you have the old ones or the new ones. Okay, sorry. St. Louis de Montfort says that Mary is a short path to Jesus. It is short because Mary guides our steps and keeps us on the narrow path to heaven. She helps us to resist temptation and renounce our self-will. When St. Louis de Montfort states that by obeying Mary's inspirations, which are the inspirations of the Holy Spirit, we will obtain victory over our enemies. And our enemies are the world, the flesh, and the devil. As stated in 156, Mary will help you to become an elder in light and holiness, in experience and in wisdom, that you will arrive in a few years at the fullness of the age of Jesus Christ. So what is meant by the fullness of the age of Jesus Christ? And what that means is that in his humanity, he grew to perfection. He was perfect because he was God, right? But as we said, he was not born able to read and write, and you know, he was taught these things, and scripture tells us he grew in wisdom, age, and grace. Well, who do you think taught him? Blessed Mother and Father, St. Joseph as well. St. Basil's like, don't forget St. Joseph. You know, boys had to learn their manhood from their fathers. And so, of course, St. Joseph was there. But the Blessed Mother, being perfect and sinless, had greater gifts of the Spirit, and so was able to raise Jesus to be the perfect man in his humanity. And so why would we not want to avail ourselves to this mother who can also move us along the paths of spiritual maturity? You know, teach us how to suffer well, like we just talked about. Teach us how to pray better. You know, teach us how to surrender ourselves. Teach us how to live for others, you know, and not ourselves. Teach us how to purge ourselves of sinfulness. All these things that we've talked about all year is growing in spiritual maturity. And what St. Louis de Montfort says is that in little time, you know, if you really are serious about this, about growing in sainthood, which you are because you're still coming, then Mary, if you give yourself over to her, she will go to work on you, you know, and you'll start feeling it. You know, not to say you won't have spiritual dryness, but she'll teach you how to live in that dryness, you know, how to live in your sufferings. And so I just want to read to you, that's actually taken, that terminology is taken from Scripture, this fullness of the age of Jesus Christ. It's Ephesians 4:13. And I'm going to read you Ephesians 10 to 15 just to get it in context. It says, Ephesians 10 or 11. He gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers. He gave some, this is a very small print, so I got to move it closer to me. I can't see. Okay, sorry. So he gave some to be all of those things for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, until we come in the unity of faith, and in the knowledge of the Son of God, unto the perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of the age of Jesus Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, sometimes you'll see infants, tossed to and fro and carried about by the every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men, by the cunning craftiness of the devil, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, we may grow up in him in all things, which is the head, Jesus Christ. So that's where that comes from. And so the Blessed Mother, even though we're children, she helps us not to be childish. Okay, we're childlike, but we don't want to be childish and all those things that we've already talked about, you know. So get back to the question here. Spiritual maturity, you know, and we want to become as spiritually mature as we can in this life. It says Mary helps us to grow up in Christ. Okay, she helps us to die to selfishness, childishness, revenge, envy, pettiness, gossip, vanity, self-pity, comfort-seeking. She helps us to die to these things. She gives us, or through devotion to her, as we've read, the Holy Spirit. You know, we increase the gifts of fortitude and wisdom, the gifts and the fruits of the Spirit. Okay, she helps us to have self-knowledge, which is really what it keeps coming back to, is really self-knowledge. You know, the more you know yourself, the more you can root things out, the more you can empty yourself of your selfishness and be filled with God. As we already talked about, she teaches us the wisdom of the cross. She helps us to grow in virtue. And finally, as I've already said, she helps us to know who we are. Children of the Father, beloved, precious, irreplaceable, important. Gosh, how we could get this message out to the world. To the world who's been so deceived. You know, so much insecurity and lack of knowing who you are masks itself in pride. You know, we think everybody's proud and arrogant, and it's really that there's deep insecurity there. People don't know who they are. They don't know their dignity. And that's where they have that. That's why they have so much suffering. Their crosses are heavy. And that's why we have to try not to get disgusted at people, try not to get angry at people. You know, really, the Blessed Mother has tried to teach me to pity people who hurt me. You know, they know not what they do. You know, that's such an attitude of love. You know, and so that's the kind of things that the Blessed Mother teaches us. Then we can carry the heavier crosses of persecution and these kinds of things, you know, because we're doing what we should be doing and defending our faith with boldness and love and clarity and enthusiasm and joy. These kinds of things, that's hard for us sometimes. You know, the Blessed Mother wants to heal us of all that junk so that we can go out, and we're in the new evangelization right now, the year of faith, the new evangelization. You know, John Paul II and Benedict, they're prophets. They saw this glorious church, and it's coinciding with the age of Mary as no coincidence. You know, and we're part of that. So we want to get healed. Keep getting healed. Go to Jesus, you know. The world seeks drugs and all these other ways, and they don't come to the divine healer. And so we have to keep availing ourselves to the divine healer. Okay, let's move on. The perfect way. Okay, so this, now we've done easy, we've done short. You'll grow quicker than if you weren't without Mary's help. And finally, perfect. Now this paragraph, Father Patrick Gaffney, who was a Montfort father, he said this is his favorite paragraph in the book because of it's so profound. And so, you know, maybe take this paragraph in front of the Blessed Sacrament and just read it slowly and let it really soak into you how profound it is. I had a man last year or the year before said, I did that. Wow, it's really profound. You know, so anyway, and he refers to Mary as the little Mary in this paragraph again, which is what Father Gately realized, you know, the little Mary, she's just tender and gentle and little. She's not up there, you know, like some moms with their hand on their hip, you know, pointing their finger, maybe like we do sometimes with our kids, you know, she's gentle and tender and loving. Okay, it's a perfect way. This practice of devotion to our Blessed Lady is also a perfect path by which we go and unite ourselves to Jesus. Because the Divine Mary, and divine with a small d, just want to make sure I point that out, is the most perfect and the most holy of creatures. And because Jesus, who has come to us most perfectly, took no other road for his great and admirable journey, the Most High, the incomprehensible and inaccessible, he who is, has willed to come to us, little worms of the earth who are nothing. Okay, so remember, you are dust, to dust you shall return. Okay. I lost my spot. Okay, or nothing. How has he done this? The Most High has come down to us perfectly and divinely by the humble Mary, without losing anything of his divinity and sanctity. So it is by Mary that the very little ones are to ascend perfectly and divinely without any fear to the Most High. The incomprehensible has allowed himself to be comprehended and perfectly contained by the little Mary, without losing anything of his immensity. So also is it by the little Mary that we must let ourselves be contained and guided perfectly without any reserve. The inaccessible has drawn near to us and has united himself closely, perfectly, and even personally to our humanity by Mary, without losing anything of his majesty. So also it is by Mary that we must draw near to God and unite ourselves perfectly and closely to his majesty, without fear of being repulsed. In a word, he who is has willed to come to that which is not, and to make that which is not become he who is. And he has done this perfectly in giving himself and subjecting himself entirely to the young Virgin Mary, without ceasing to be in time who he is from all eternity. In like manner, it is by Mary that we who are nothing can become like to God by grace and glory, by giving ourselves to her so perfectly and entirely as to be nothing in ourselves but everything in her without fear of delusion. So he's using, as we've talked about so many times, he's using logic really to try to get us to see that God came to us through this perfect creature, and that we should go through this perfect creature back to him. And he's hoping that that just makes sense to us. Now again, as we've said, the church does not require us to go through Mary or anything like that, but let's avail ourselves to this. You know, basically that's what he's saying, is if we just stop for a minute and think about the path, this is called the perfect path. Jesus chose this path to come to us. Let's go back to him, this perfect path. It's perfect because he is the one who made it. You know, he laid the foundation of this path. We can walk on this path that's already been laid for us back to him without fear. And we've talked about without fear, you know, and as we talked about the Jansenists many, many times, they had fear of trembling of God, you know, and not that we don't know. We still try to do the best we can. But there's less fear with her. Because as I said, God sees me, he sees her, you know, and that just brings me a lot of comfort. Okay, and then St. Louis de Montfort even goes further, saying that there you could come up with the greatest, most awesome path with comforts and consolation. I would still choose the path of Mary. Basically, it's beautiful how he says this, 158. He says, make for me, if you will, a new road to go to Jesus, and pave it with all the merits of the blessed. Adorn it with all their heroic virtues. Illuminate and embellish it with all their lights, all the lights and beauties of the angels. And let all the angels and saints be there themselves to escort, defend, and sustain those who are ready to walk there. And yet in truth, in simple truth, I say boldly, and I repeat what I say truly, I would prefer to this new perfect path the immaculate way of Mary. He made my way blameless. It is the way without stain or spot, without original or actual sin, without shadow or darkness. When my sweet Jesus comes a second time on earth in his glory, as is most certain he will do, to reign there, he will choose no other way for his journey than the Divine Mary, by whom he came the first time so surely and so perfectly. But there will be a difference between his first and his last coming. The first time he came securely and hiddenly, or secretly, I'm sorry, and hiddenly. The second time he will come gloriously and resplendently. But both times he will have come perfectly, because both times he will have come by Mary. Alas, here is a mystery which is not understood. Here let all tongues be mute. So again, he's using what he thinks is logic. You know, Jesus is going to come again. He's going to come by his mother again. Why wouldn't he? It's the perfect path. It's the road that he laid out. And so he's just really trying to get us to see that you can try going your own way, but why wouldn't you go the path of Mary? You know, the graces that are there, she's spotless, she's pure, she's perfect. Why wouldn't we avail ourselves to that? You know, basically is what he's saying. And for those on the video watching, every time I say the word divine, he's not using that to mean equal to God. He uses a small d, so it's like we would say, oh, that dessert is divine, you know. It really means it's really great. So I just want to make sure I'm pointing that out to those who are listening. Okay, let's go on to this last part, which is it's a secure way. Okay, and this is divided into two parts. The first part, he shows us that he did not invent this. I think we've mentioned that before. A lot of people think St. Louis de Montfort came up with total consecration. He did not. You know, he gave it a beautiful expression, an easier way to understand. He defined it probably deeper than anyone ever had before him, but he did not invent it. As a matter of fact, we could say it goes back to Christ, you know, that Jesus was totally devoted to his mother. The early church, I read one of the, I don't know if it was one of the early church fathers, but said that as she raised the infant Christ, she helped raise the infant church, that she was there with the church in its infancy to help mother the apostles, you know. So that sounds perfectly logical to me. You know, why wouldn't she? So he starts out by saying, first, that it's not new. Secondly, he gives his own reasonings why she's a secure path, which I love that part. But he says here in 159, this devotion to our Blessed Lady is also a secure way to go to Jesus and to acquire perfection by uniting ourselves to him. It is a secure way because the practice which I am teaching is nothing new. Father Boudon, who died a short time ago in the Order of Sanctity, says in a book which he composed on this devotion that it is so ancient that we cannot fix precisely the date of its beginning. It is, however, certain that for more than 700 years we find traces of it in the church. Well, that was the year 1000. And as I said, he gives all these examples. We're going to skip all these paragraphs here. I'm not going to read them. But he gives all these examples of saints that he knew. Remember, he was a librarian, so he had a lot of time to read. And so I'm sure he tried to find back as far as he could what was written of those who had totally consecrated themselves. But he says here in 163, if you can skip ahead, he says, we may also see in Father Boudon's book the different popes who have approved this devotion, the theologians who have examined it, the persecutions it has undergone and has overcome, and the thousands of persons who have embraced it without any pope ever having condemned it. Indeed, we cannot see how it could be condemned without overturning the foundations of Christianity. So he's pretty strong in his belief of this, obviously. Okay, let's go on, because this really, part number two, we'll end with this. He says, this devotion is a secure means of going to Jesus Christ because it is the very characteristic of our Blessed Lady to conduct us surely to Jesus, just as it is the very characteristic of Jesus to conduct us surely to the Father. Spiritual persons, therefore, must not fall into the false belief that Mary can be a hindrance to them in attaining divine union. For is it possible that she who has found grace before God, for the whole world in general, and for each person in particular, should be a hindrance to a soul in finding the great grace of union with him? Can it be possible that she who has been full of superabounding with graces, so united and transformed into God, that it has been kind of a necessity that he should be incarnate in her, should be a stumbling block in the way of a soul's perfect union with God? It is quite true that in the view of other creatures, however holy, may perhaps at certain times retard divine union. But this cannot be said of Mary, as I have remarked before and shall never weary of repeating. I'll put a star by this. One reason why so few souls come to the fullness of the age of Jesus Christ is that Mary, who as much as ever the mother of the Son and as much as ever the fruitful spouse of the Holy Ghost, is not sufficiently formed in their hearts. He who wishes to have the fruit well ripened and well formed must have the tree that reproduces it. He who wishes to have the fruit of life, Jesus Christ, must have the tree of life, which is Mary. He who wishes to have in himself the operation of the Holy Ghost must have his faithful and inseparable spouse, the divine Mary, who makes him fertile and fruit-bearing, as we have said elsewhere. So that's just big stars by that, because for some reason, it's not well known. I don't know why. Pope John Paul II definitely tried to make it more well known. Even Pope Benedict, when he retired, called her Mediatrix of All Graces. I don't know if you read that or not. But he referred to her as Mediatrix of All Graces. I mean, they are trying to help the world see her importance. And if you really take the time to go back and read the Vatican II documents, then there's tons of stuff about Mary. You know, so St. Louis de Montfort is trying to help us to understand, if you really want to feel the power of the Holy Ghost, people say, you know, I have the gift. I have a charismatic gift, a gift of the Holy Spirit of teaching. You know, this is not on my own strength. You know, this was a gift given to me. And people say, wow, how do you do it? Well, I'm devoted to Mary, and I say, Holy Spirit, bring it on. You know, I mean, I'm like, I get bossy with the Holy Spirit. I'm like, all right, I got Mary, and so I want you to give me gifts, and I want a lot of them, and I want all the gifts that nobody else wants, you know? And he does. You can pray that way. You know, you can be demanding with the God and with the Holy Spirit. But I am confident to pray this way because of her, because I am close to her. And so, closer you get to her, you start. We are not supposed to live as Catholics like the world. I mean, we are supposed to be experiencing miracles. We are supposed to be speaking with power. We are supposed to be, you know, bringing about the conversion of souls. We have to take hold of our destiny here, you know. And the reason why it's so hard and why we're not seeing it is because we're not including our mother. And so once you bring her into the picture, totally consecrate yourself to her and trust it and believe it, you can start asking, God, work miracles through me. And he will. He will. He wants to. You are very needed in the world right now. Okay, in your own families, in your own little circles. But then as we said, everything you offer her, it's going out all over the world. Places that we will never know until we get to heaven and see. And St. Louis de Montfort tells us later in the book, there'll be a multitude of people waiting to greet you. You know, how beautiful will that be? Okay, let's look at the... Oh, no, I'm sorry. We got to read a little bit more here, and then we'll look at these last two questions. That they don't take too long to get through. I know we're getting close on time. So he says here in 165, he's so convinced of what he just said that he starts, be persuaded. He's probably yelling it as he's writing it, you know, please believe me. Be persuaded then that the more you look at Mary in your prayers, contemplations, actions, and sufferings, if not with a distinct and definite view, at least with a general and imperceptible one, the more perfectly you will find Jesus Christ, who is always with Mary, great, powerful, active, and incomprehensible, more than in heaven or in any other creature. Thus, so far from the divine Mary, all absorbed in God, being an obstacle to the perfect in attaining union with God, there has never been up to this time, and there never will be, any creature who will aid us more efficaciously in this great work, either by the graces she will communicate to us for this purpose, for as a saint has said, no one can be filled with the thought of God except by her, Mediatrix, right there, or by the protection she will afford us against the illusions and trickeries of the evil spirit. Okay, this is actually the answer to the next question, number four, I guess, or three on mine. Before we read that, I want to just comment here. He's saying that the more you look at Mary, if not definitely, you know, if not really looking at her, thinking of her, at least with a view that she's there, you know, he says here, if not with a distinct and definite view, at least with a general and imperceptible one. You know, so we don't always have to say, Jesus, I come to you through Mary. Or, you know, we don't always have to say that. We don't have to worry that, oh, I forgot to include Mary. You know, it's just awareness that she's there, that she's with you. You know, he's saying the more that you can become aware. Now, I do say, as I've said many, many times, I do say through Mary I come to you because it just makes me feel, you know, closer to her. And it reminds me of how happy Jesus is to see his mother with me. So, you know, I try to say it. Now, every novena do I say it? No, I don't. But anyway, that's what he's trying to say here, just increase your awareness. Okay, so let's answer that question. And it says, St. Louis de Montfort has explained how total consecration to Mary is an easy, short, and perfect path to union with God. In this final section of Motive 5, he describes how this devotion is a secure and safe way of attaining Christian perfection. His explanation is divided into two parts, as we said. First, he gives some history of the slavery of love to show that centuries before him, many saints and scholars went to Jesus through Mary, as is evident in the writings. Father Gaffney says, this list is far from complete. Secondly, St. Louis de Montfort gives us his own reasons to convince us of the certainty of the path of Mary. What two specific ways does he say that Mary will aid us in attaining union with God? Okay, this is really a summary of what we've been talking about, but he says it here at the very end of this paragraph that we just read. So if you want to write paragraph 165 in your answer, you'll know that's where you find it. So it's number one, two ways. Number one, the graces she will communicate to you. She's mediatrix of all grace, dispensatrix of all grace. So she does give you more graces. And not only that, but you start asking for more graces. You know, you become aware that she's the mediatrix of all grace, and so you go to her. Okay, so she either gives you graces to help you, or number two, she protects you from the devil. She protects you from his tricks and his deception and his lies. And either, sometimes I think her mantle's around me and the arrows just bounce off her mantle and they don't even get to me. That's one way. Or if by God's will, I'm allowed to be tempted and I start falling into distress or sadness or discouragement or doubt or these little, you know, these things, eventually she shows me. You know, might not be right away, it might be a few days, it might be a month. I mean, it might not be right away, depending how long God wants me to maybe to struggle with something, some sin, or maybe he's trying to make me aware of some sin. And so you don't get that consolation right away, maybe. But she shows you his tricks. And providentially, this morning at the 8 o'clock mass, Father Basil Cole talked about the devil, and I was like, "Oh, this is just so amazing!" You know, but he talked about that the devil, he tricks us in two main ways, and they're both extremes. Okay, before I give you those two extreme ways, I want to define delusion and illusion, because we've come across that a couple of times. That she keeps you from, I could think in the last paragraph, illusions. And the delusions. Yeah, here it is. By the protection she will afford us against the illusions and trickeries of the evil spirit. So I want to just define illusion and delusion, because we see this in the world today, big time. So delusion is a stronger one. So delusion is acceptance of a false belief despite evidence to the contrary. So we all know people like, you try to convince them, you just can't convince them. They're believing an error, they're believing a lie. Like one example we see today is an ultrasound. You cannot deny that is a human person there, but you still have people who are hanging on to their denial that it's not, or some other lie, right? So we are living in a world of people that are delusional. An illusion is a little bit less, that is, a false impression based on the senses or the imagination, and is usually easily overcome by evidence shown. So this would be like, you know, you hear something and you're not sure if it's true or not, or maybe you believe it's true, but then somebody, or, you know, you pray about it and it doesn't feel so right, you know. And I do this a lot of times, like with a lot of different apparitions and emails, and I'll pray. Blessed Mother, you know, is this an illusion? Is this real? Is this false? And a lot of times I just get a feeling, you know, and I think that she just shows you some, and I can't put a finger on it. You know, I can't explain it necessarily why I think something's wrong, but you know how you just know. She gives you discernment. Okay, the gift of discernment, and that is a gift. And we really need to pray for that gift because there's so much heresy flying around, you know. So the two extremes of delusions then are, and Father Basil talked about this at Mass this morning. He said the one extreme is to think that I don't sin or that I don't need to, you know, lines for confession aren't very long. St. Gertrude they are, but we're blessed. But, you know, there's not even hours for confession anymore. People believe that I create my own good. All I have to do is do good, and they kind of, they don't need God, and they don't, they can do it themselves. Okay, so that's a delusion. The other end of delusions is I'm too sinful to be forgiven. All right, so the devil tries to take us to one extreme or the other. And both are delusions because, you know, in both cases, you're not seeing God for who he is. You're not seeing God as the merciful Savior. And you're not seeing that you need grace to do anything meritorious. You have to have grace. You know, we can't do it on our own. He even said that, his exact words were, we need grace to do things, to do meritorious deeds. I was like, this is just amazing, that the timing of that. All right, so the devil, and he also said this, he said the devil tricks our imagination. All right, the devil can only work on your intellect and your imagination. You know, that's he can only try to throw lies out at you, you see. And when you got the Blessed Mother, either, like I said, the lies just bounce right off her and they don't even get to you. Or again, that discernment kicks in, you know, maybe not right away. You might go, you know, and actually let's read the next paragraph because he says that. He says, you might believe for a while a falsehood, but it won't be for long. You know, it won't be for long. You're not gonna remain in a false belief for long with her help. She's not gonna let you. You know, she's gonna bother you. She's gonna wake you up in the middle of the night. She's gonna say, What are you doing? That's not right. All right, so 167. Or wait, I'm sorry. 166. Where Mary is, the evil spirit is not. One of the most infallible marks we can have of our being conducted by the good spirit, which is the Holy Spirit, is our being very devout to Mary. Now underline this, thinking often of her and speaking often of her. So that's a prerequisite. This is the thought of a saint who adds that as respiration is a certain sign that the body is not dead, the frequent thought and loving invocation of Mary is a certain sign that the soul is not dead by sin. Okay, so if unfortunately you do fall into mortal sin, she's going to be on you so fast. You know, she really is. She'll try to get you to see the error of your thinking. Okay, that's a great gift because there are there's a lot of falsehood floating around, and we have to be aware. Even things that sound really good, look really good. You know, the way I look at it is I am just not smart enough to figure it out on my own. I'm just not, you know. That's why I need someone showing it and spelling it out for me. Okay, all right, and then he says here, as it is Mary alone, says the church, and the Holy Ghost who guides the church, who makes all heresies come to naught, thou alone hast destroyed all heresies in the whole world. We may be sure that however critics may grumble, no faithful client of Mary will ever fall into heresy or illusions, at least formal ones. He may very well err materially, take falsehood for truth and the evil spirit for the good. And yet he will do this even less readily than others. But sooner or later he will acknowledge his material fault and error. And when he knows it, he will not be in any way self-opinionated by continuing to believe and maintain what he had once thought true. Okay, so when he says sometimes you take the evil spirit for the good, because they ain't, Scripture tells us that the devil doesn't just come right out, you know, as evil. He comes as an angel of light. He comes to make it look really good and really pleasing. And that's why when you get a thought to do something good, you know, bring it to prayer. We've talked about that. Take some time to really pray if it's God's will. Because the devil is so good at pulling you away from your duties, you know, your duties of your state. All right. There's one last question. What is formal heresy and how will Mary keep us from it? All right, I'm going to give you the catechism's definition. Oh, I forgot this quote. I'm going to read it, St. Faustina's diary again. This is about meditating on the Passion, which we should be doing during Lent. Jesus told St. Faustina, so this is Jesus' own words, 737. He says, "There are few souls who contemplate my Passion with true feeling. I give great graces to souls who meditate devoutly on my Passion." Right there. You know, Jesus himself says he wants us, you know, he wants us to love him. You know, we often focus on how much he loves us, and he does, but he wants us, he thirsts for our love for him. You know, that's why St. Therese had so understood that. That's why she desired to make little acts of love. That's why she said, "I'll let him rest." You know, he wants us, he thirsts as if we're the only person, you know, and actually I'm going to send you, someone sent it to me. It's so beautiful. Mother Teresa's words on I thirst. And it's so beautiful. I'll send it to you along with that video when I get home. I already had someone remind me in an email, so it's I will do it. I wanted to do this group first. But it's so beautiful. And just to understand how much, that's why, like I said, you know, when we drive by a Catholic church, you know, we wave at Jesus and, you know, I try to, who's not waving? Did you wave at Jesus? He is waiting for you. He wants you to wave at him. You know, I try, but I want them to understand that it's not just like a good deed to wave at Jesus, you know. It's like, okay, I get more merit now. I waved at Jesus. No, it's because I want him to see that I see him as I'm driving by. And I want him to know that I acknowledge him, and that not for my sake, but for his, because he longs for us to notice him, you know. And I just think sometimes we're so focused on ourselves and our merit and our doing our good deeds and making sure we're sheep and not goats. And, you know, we're so focused on that that sometimes we forget that he just wants us to make little acts of love toward him. Okay. And that is why he wants us to look at his Passion. He wants us to love him through it and thank him for it and to see his love. Okay. Catechism 2089 says, formal heresy is the obstinate post-baptismal denial of some truth which must be believed with divine and Catholic faith. The Code of Canon Law 750 says, all that is contained in the written word of God or in tradition, that is, in the one deposit of faith entrusted to the church and also proposed as divinely inspired either by the solemn magisterium of the church or by its ordinary and universal magisterium, must be believed with divine and Catholic faith. So basically, the tenets of the faith with devotion to the Blessed Mother, she will help you not to deny basic tenets of the faith, the teaching of the church, you know. And I think she brings that about pretty quickly. Like, she helps enlighten you to the meaning of things, you know, why the church teaches this, you know. And a lot of times we struggle with, well, I believe that, but I don't know how to explain it, you know, the whys behind why the church says this or that. And without spending hours and days of reading it, the Blessed Mother just kind of gives you that light so that when you are in a situation where someone says, well, why does the church teach that? You know, she helps it so that it's such a part of you that you're able to explain it better. Do you know what I mean? Now, I'm not saying we should be reading and we should be trying to find out ourselves so that we can explain it better, but it's just she helps you to make the truth become such a part of who you are that it's like explaining, you know, about your family or something, because it is your family, right? So, okay. Well, let's end with this last paragraph. I'll make sure I answered everything. Okay, I think I did. Okay, I did. All right, so let's end then. Sorry, we're a little over, but this last paragraph is beautiful. 168 and 169, we'll end with that. Oh no, it's just 168, okay. Whoever then wishes to put aside the fear of illusion, which is the besetting timidity of men of prayer, and to advance in the way of perfection, and surely and perfectly find Jesus Christ, let him embrace with great heartedness, with a great heart and a willing mind, this devotion to our Blessed Lady, which perhaps he has not known before. Let him enter into this excellent way, which was unknown to him and which I now point out. I show you a more excellent way. It is the path trodden by Jesus Christ, the incarnate wisdom, our soul head. One of his members cannot make a mistake in passing by the same road. And then here's the summary. It is an easy road because of the fullness of the grace and the unction of the Holy Ghost, which fills it to overflowing. No one wearies there. No one walking there ever has to retrace his steps. It is a short road, which leads us to Jesus in little time. It is a perfect road where there is not mud. There is no mud, no dust, not the least spot of sin. Lastly, it is a secure road, which conducts us to Jesus Christ and life eternal in a straight and secure manner, without turning to the right hand or to the left. Let us then set forth upon that road and walk there day and night until we come to the fullness of the age of Jesus Christ. So, hope you enjoyed that section. I hope it was helpful to you, because I really think that the whole suffering, you know, we really need reminders. Yes, and I had a lady Tuesday who just lost her father, and he lived this. And it was such a beautiful witness, you know, to her, to know someone that really embraced the cross, you know. So we want to learn to suffer well. I want to learn to suffer well, because we're going to suffer no matter what, right? This is not our home, you know. So let's go to our mother so that we can suffer well and be a witness to the world. Because the world is longing, really, really longing to have what we have. You know, how blessed we are. So we'll end here, and let's end in prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, we just give you thanks and praise for your glory, for your goodness, for your love for us, for allowing us to be here, and allowing us to learn this, to learn the wisdom of the cross. We ask you to help us when we become weak and when we fall and we forget the wisdom of the cross. And we thank you because we know that by drawing close to the Blessed Mother, that this will be more forefront in our minds. And we give you thanks. And we ask you to take care of our sick and suffering, those who have asked us to pray for them, and especially in our own families, Lord, where we experience a lot of our suffering. And we just ask you to send your mother to wrap her mantle around all of them and to help them to see the wisdom of the cross as well. And we ask all of this through Mother's heart in your holy name, Jesus, as we pray the memorary. Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, sought thy intercession, was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto thee, O Virgin of Virgins, my Mother. To thee I come, before thee I stand, sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of the Word incarnate, despise not our petitions, but in thy mercy hear and answer us. Amen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, thank you.